You know, you mentioned my old advisor, Sidney Coleman, who's now passed away. But my favorite story about Sidney is he would always get up. He would stay up very, very late and then come in about noon. He would get up, come in, amble into the Department of Physics at the crack of noon. And he would stumble in. We were having the gauge seminar every Wednesday. We would have a seminar on grand unified theories. And he would stumble into that. And I remember one day, one classic day, and this has just become famous in the whole community, the speaker was saying, you know, that's a good question. I don't know the answer to that. Sidney happened to walk in right at that moment, and he said, I know the answer. What's the question? And had the speaker repeat the question, and sure enough, he did know the answer. So he was a great man, and it's too bad that he passed away. Okay, so I'm going to tell you about quantum gravity, and it's a really opportune time to talk about quantum gravity, because after years and years and years of the field just being kind of nonsense, kind of la-la land, a student of mine once dismissed it as la-la land, you know, telling your own advisor that it's la-la land, that takes real guts, and it's a measure of how screwed up it was, and the reason it was screwed up is because there was no data. Finally, after all of these years, there is data, and a lot of it, about 10 to the 12 pixels of data with a huge amount more on the way. It's been calculated that it can be increased by about a factor of 10 to the 18. So huge, huge amounts, and it's actually, this is causing it to become of age, to become a real scientific field as opposed to just nonsense. Okay, so I have to tell you about quantum gravity, and what it is the union of three things. The theory of gravity, just the thing that's doing that. The theory of relativity, which is what describes physics when physical effects, when you have relative velocities that are near the speed of light. And quantum mechanics, which imposes a funny restriction on physics that is very important. And two of these things go together in a non-quantum mechanical theory, which is the thing that Albert Einstein did for us, which is if you put together nonlinear gravity and relativity, you get something called general relativity. And that was the thing that Albert Einstein did, and it'll actually be 100 years next year that he proposed that theory, and we physicists are having a big 100th anniversary party for it. And this theory, if you don't include quantum mechanics, just is perfect. We've done measurements of it. You actually do measurements every time you use the GPS system. You're using it, and it predicts all kinds of interesting effects. For example, one of them that the GPS has to take into account is that time moves a little bit slower down here on Earth because we're in a heavy gravitational field than it moves up in orbit where the satellites are, and they have to take that into account. In fact, if you guys were nerds taking general relativity, it would be a standard homework problem to use the fact the teacher would tell you that you have to go to second order in general relativity in order, the military has to, in order to get their GPS, and you should therefore be able to figure out how accurate they can determine distances, and in fact you can do that. So this is a great theory, and as far as we can tell, it works perfectly if we do a certain thing. That is, if we just ignore all the fluctuations, if we just say that almost all the dynamical variables are zero, almost all of the things that could have been oscillating and moving around, they're almost all zero, then we get perfect agreement. And classically, there is no reason at all why you can't do that, and that's why they say general relativity is such a great theory. However, there is quantum mechanics, and even if you don't want to quantize the dynamical gravitational degrees of freedom, gravity is sourced by matter. For example, the gravitational field that we're feeling right now is sourced by that matter, and we have enormously powerful evidence that that is quantum mechanical. Quantum mechanics imposes a peculiar thing, which says that each degree of freedom must fluctuate a little. For any one degree of freedom, no big deal. But a field, a quantum field, has an infinite number of degrees of freedom because it's got a value at each point in space and time, okay? And so that's an infinite number of degrees of freedom. They all have to be fluctuating a little bit. And when you take that little bit of fluctuation, that little bit of energy that's associated with that fluctuation of each one of them, and add all infinite numbers of them together, you get an infinite gravitational effect. In fact, theory predicts that if I wave my hand like this, we were all just fried to crisps of bacon by hard graviton radiation. Well, theory's a little bit wrong, and we want to figure out how, okay? So each of those three theories, gravity, special relativity, and quantum mechanics, has its own coupling constant, has its own fundamental constant. The constant of gravity is called Newton's constant, G. If you've ever taken a theory of physics, an elementary physics course, you know this thing. For example, Newton's 1 over r squared force law is that mass m1 attracts mass m2 at a distance r with a magnitude, with a force in magnitude equal to G times m1 m2 over r squared. And G numerically is about 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11 meters to the third over kilograms second squared. The special constant of relativity is the speed of light, not unsurprisingly, because special relativity is the thing that describes what goes on when you get to moving close to the speed of light. That's about 3 times 10 to the 8th meters per second. And the special constant of quantum mechanics is called the reduced Planck's constant, H bar. And it's about 1.054 times 10 to the minus 4 kilogram meter squared per second. Okay, and each of those constants is important because that prediction of gravity that I told you that goes so wrong, it turns out that every single quantity in quantum gravity, if you're talking about a process, like, for example, me waving my arm, that's characterized by a frequency. We'll call it omega. That's the frequency, 2 pi times the frequency by which I'm waving my arm. So if I'm waving it up and down once a second, then it's 2 pi hertz. Okay? And quantum gravity predicts that all the effects of quantum gravity, if you're talking about a process with frequency omega, go like the dimensionless combination h bar g omega squared over c squared. So if you put all of those things together, and you had a c, 1 over c to the fifth times a g times an h bar times an omega squared, you would wind up with a pure number. All the meters and the kilograms and everything would cancel out. You'd have a dimensionless constant, and the result for everything takes this form. It's that constant to the first power times a pure number. We might call it alpha naught. That's the thing that agrees, well, sorry. So there's a pure number, alpha naught, and then another pure number times alpha 1 times this constant squared, and then another pure number, alpha 2, times that constant to the third power, and there's an infinite series of effects. Okay, and there are two problems with this. The first problem is that we're physicists, so we don't just like to take this result. We like we don't like to just accept that. We like to subject it to meaningful experimental scrutiny, because sometimes our theoretical predictions are wrong. Maybe Einstein was wrong about the theory of gravity. Maybe quantum mechanics is a little bit wrong. We'd like to subject that to experimental scrutiny, to do experiments and then see. And the trouble, the first problem of quantum gravity is that for any frequency that we can reach in the laboratory, this dimensionless number is hopelessly too small to measure. So for example, FM radio would have an omega of about 10 to the 8th hertz, megahertz, right? And that's a big number, but G and H bar are so small and C is so big that if you put that together, this is an incredibly small number, 10 to the minus 71. And we have never measured anything in physics so small, nor will we ever measure anything in physics so small. In fact, you can prove that if you created an apparatus to do that, it would cause the Earth to collapse into a black hole. It is just impossible to do that measurement. And so that means that we can't. For anything that we can actually, any frequency that we can actually do, we cannot test this theory. However, I told you it makes a wildly wrong prediction, and that is that these coefficients alpha, the usual assumption in quantum field theory, which is what this is that those constants alpha 1, alpha 2, et cetera, those are of order 1. And this guy is of order 1. That guy, however, is infinity. And that guy is also infinity. And infinity is a big number, and no matter how small that number is, that the combination of infinity times that small number is big. So in a certain sense, we can test this. We can see that you're not all fried to crisps of bacon, so it's wrong. And we'd like to figure out how to fix it, okay? So those are the two problems. But if we did fix that, if we did get rid of the divergences, then we'd just be, you know, messed up because we'd get a theory that was just hopelessly too small to test. Or to say it another way, suppose I think 15% of the American public believes they've been abducted by aliens, and probably a larger fraction believe that aliens come down and land. Suppose one landed down here and said, you know, Dr. Woodward, I know the theory of quantum gravity, it's this. And then another one landed at the same time or a little bit later and said, no, that's not right, it's this. How would I tell the difference? I couldn't do it. Because with an earthbound lab, because it's just too small, the numbers are just too small for me to make an observation and tell that. Okay? So, need to go forward here. So, actually, physics is sort of coming off of, you know how drug users and alcoholics go on binges of drug use and alcoholism? Well, physics is sort of coming off of a binge of a wrong belief. That wrong belief was that we could solve this problem just based on mathematical consistency. And some of you have probably heard of something called string theory. My colleagues in string theory make wild, incredible claims. In 1996, they said that they were going to solve string theory exactly within 5 to 10 years. And we don't know how long a year was back in 1996, but I think it's been a little bit longer than 5 to 10 years. They didn't solve it exactly, and it was already obvious they weren't going to do this. Let me not criticize it too much, because sorry about that. These guys are my friends, and also I'm up for funding renewal this year, and they would probably be sitting on my grant renewal proposal, and if I say too much bad stuff about them, they'll deny me funding. Let me just convict them using their own words, okay? So this is from a website put up by one of them at Santa Barbara, a guy named Steve Giddings. These guys are all my friends. This guy is a friend of mine. And this is listing what they themselves consider to be the big problems in M theory, which is their version of string theory. So first is, what are the fundamental degrees of freedom? Mind you, if I teach electromagnetism, for example, if somebody asked me that, I would say, okay, for electromagnetism, it's the electric and magnetic fields and maybe the charges and currents that cause them. Here, they say they don't know. We don't know what that is. What are the dynamical laws governing them? What are the observables? So what is it that you calculate in them? I'm tempted to echo Gertrude Stein, the famous critic, literary critic of the Lost Generation, when she was criticizing the city of Oakland, California. The trouble with Oakland is that when you get there, there isn't any there. What is string theory if they won't say what it's a theory of, or what equations it obeys, or even what you're supposed to try and calculate in it? They also have a record, the few things that they've tried to predict, they've gotten wrong. For example, you guys have probably taken multiple choice questions, right, in science courses. Okay, so there's a certain constant in Einstein's theory called the cosmological constant. A priori, it could have been positive, could have been zero, or it could have been negative. On an American multiple choice test, the string theorist bet that it would either be zero or negative. That's what string theory predicted. They measured it in 1998, and it turned out that it was positive. So they got it wrong. They had a two-thirds chance of just guessing it right, and their great theory got it wrong. And when they, by the way, were told the result, a famous string theorist, another guy who's a friend of mine, said, I'm sure the data is wrong. He didn't know how to form the plural of data. I'm sure the data is wrong, or he didn't know how to form the singular of data, is wrong because string theory predicts a negative cosmological constant, and if it's right, I'll quit doing physics. And it's debatable about whether he's kept his word or not, because what he's doing right now is string theory, and well. So anyway, let me not attack them too much, but I think the point is made that just on the basis of math and aesthetics and consistency, we are not going to get the answer. Humans are just not good enough guessers to try and get the answer that way. We're going to have to be guided the same way we were everything else. We didn't guess quantum mechanics. We didn't guess general relativity or special relativity. We were guided by data. We're going to have to be guided by data in this case. And the really interesting thing about quantum gravity is that cosmology is providing that data. So I'm going to have to tell you a little bit about cosmology, just a little bit. And I'm not going to get into any heavy calculus, but I'll do just a little bit. If you were a physics geek and somebody wanted to, in just one sentence, characterize everything there was to characterize about special relativity, he would say this. He would write ds squared is equal to minus c squared dt squared plus dx squared plus dy squared plus dz squared. It turns out that encompasses all statements that you could make about special relativity. And it tells you, this thing tells you how to form distances and times between events in space-time. Okay, and general relativity is what happens when you get a more complicated universe. Okay, and you can get a lot more complicated universe. But cosmology turns out to be just the next simplest thing that you can do. Okay, so instead of all the spatial deviations being constant, they have a factor in front of them. So x doesn't give you distance. It actually has to be multiplied by a. It has to be rescaled by a. And a is a function of time, hence the name scale factor. And when we nerds say that the universe is expanding, what we mean is that this thing is growing as a function of time. Okay? There are two derivatives of this thing, this scale factor, that are really, really, really important. One of them is called the Hubble parameter. It's just a dot. Dot means time derivative. So it's the derivative of a with respect to time divided by a. And it just measures how fast the universe is expanding. A lot of you have heard of the Hubble Space Telescope, right? You know all the pretty pictures that they took with the Hubble Space Telescope? You probably thought, well, we paid $1 billion to get those pictures. No. We physicists would never do anything like that to provide pictures for the humans. We don't care about the humans. The reason that we put the Hubble Space Telescope up was to measure the Hubble parameter. The Hubble Key Project was to do that. That really truly was the reason why it was supposed to be up. And it did measure the Hubble parameter to within 10%. Okay, and there's actually now a second derivative of A, which has been measured. You can write it in different ways. One way to write it is in terms of the first slow roll parameter called epsilon. So H has one time derivative. If you take another time derivative, that would be two time derivatives of it. And it's minus H dot over H squared. These guys have both been measured. And the measured value of this is given in a form that's not very easy to understand, because most of you probably don't know what a megaparsec is, although it sounds kind of neat, right? Megaparsecs? A parsec is the distance you have to go so that the distance between the Earth and the Sun subtends one arc second of angle. Okay, and it's about 3.085 times 10 to the 16th meters. So you can see that a kilometer is 10 to the third meters. That's also a length. So these are pure lengths, and this should be a frequency. And when you take account of that, it's about 2.2 times 10 to the minus 18 hertz. Okay, so the universe is expanding, but by a very, very tiny amount. And this guy is changing too. It's actually 0.47 plus or minus 0.03. I'm talking about per unit time. So when I say that the universe is changing by a tiny amount, I mean that in order to double, it takes a huge amount of time. It would take about 14 billion years for the size of the universe to double. Okay, so by the way, if anybody has questions, feel free to ask them. This is pretty informal, and I may not get to the end of everything if everybody asks a lot of questions, but that's okay. There's this famous story that they tell all beginning teachers at Harvard. It's about a lecturer who was a foreign lecturer who came to an American university, and he was lecturing on some abstract math topic, and he kept going and going and going for a whole semester. And then at the end, he thought he had given a good job. And one of the students timidly raised his hand and said, I think I understood some of the stuff that you were talking about. I was just a little bit confused. What is this thing f of x that you kept mentioning? Which, of course, meant they'd understood nothing. So let's get something across rather than nothing if I'm going too fast.
Slow roll. I didn't understand what the slow roll was all about. And then the knot comes out dimensionless, and I also
Yeah, they both, so this is dimensionful, this is dimensionless. The reason it's dimensionless is that H has the dimensions of a 1 over a time because of the derivative, the time derivative there. And so H dot is 1 over a time squared. If you divide by two H's, that's dimensionless. Is that okay?
Oh, yeah, but I don't know. And,
okay, so that... That has to do with a funny thing about inflation. So you should just take that as a name, as a proper name. But it turns out that if the universe is accelerating, if the expansion is accelerating, by which I mean the second time derivative of the sky is positive, then there's a way to drive that using a scalar, a special kind of a field. And the way to get that to happen is to have the field slowly roll down its potential. So just like a hill, it slowly rolls from the top down to the bottom, hence the name slow roll parameter. Okay, so this measures how slowly it's rolling. And if it was at zero, it would be infinitely slowly. If it was big, it would be not infinitely slowly. Okay, so but as far as we're concerned, that's just a name, just like this, named after Edwin Hubble. Okay, well, I need to give you a cautionary tale about this, and that has to do with this parameter, A double dot. I think you can see the double dot kind of got a little bit screwed up here, but you can see that it's two dots. Do we have any electrical engineers here? My nephew, my eldest nephew is an electrical engineer, so is my brother, and one thing that just drives them crazy is that Benjamin Franklin, a great American physicist, you know, back in the days when Americans still understood high school algebra, he realized an important thing. He realized that there were not two kinds of electricity. Previous to that, they thought that there were two kinds. He realized that what you got when you rubbed glass with silk and what you got when you rubbed amber with fur was really the same kind of electricity, that in this case you were just adding something to the glass, and in that case you were taking something away from the amber, but it was all the same kind of thing. And he made an arbitrary choice of sign. He had to pick one of them to be positive and one of them to be negative. He unfortunately picked this one to be positive. Oh, we all hate that. Because what's really happening when you do this is that you're stripping electrons, which have negative charge, off of the glass. And here what you're doing is adding electrons. And one consequence of Franklin's sign choice is that when you have a current moving that way, you have to remember that really what's happening is that electrons are moving that way. Oh, electrical engineers hate that. Physicists hate that. We just despise that. We like it to be that parameters always are positive, so that we can just look at an equation. We don't have to remember, oh, this one's negative, so it's going the other way around. Okay? So we clever theorists, we decided before this thing had been measured, this thing was only measured in 1998. Before it had been measured, we knew we had to make a dimensionless parameter to characterize it, and we were just sure that the universe had to be decelerating. Why? Because gravity pulls things down. You know, when you throw something up, it falls back down. Maybe you throw it with escape velocity, but it still slows down a little bit. So it's got negative acceleration. We were just sure that that's what had to be happening, that all the mass in the universe had to be causing the acceleration to slow down, okay? Had to have negative acceleration. We were certain. We were so certain, in fact, that when a friend of mine tried to get approval to measure this, he was not even given funding. But he, by calling in telescope time and everything, was able to do it anyway, and he won the 2011 Nobel Prize for doing it. And it turns out nature played a little trick on us, and in fact, actually, the acceleration of the universe is positive rather than negative. However, we didn't know that when we defined this deceleration parameter, so we put a minus sign in there so that we were going to avoid Franklin's famous sign error, and in fact, we just stumbled upon it ourselves. And the moral of all that is that you shouldn't believe anything that physicists tell you or scientists in general, including me, unless they can point to data, okay? Because some really, really smart people were absolutely certain that that sign had to be in there to keep this from becoming positive, and they were dead wrong. And I showed you what another really, really smart physicist said when he was shown the data that that supported it being negative. He just refused to believe it. And they were all wrong, and you just shouldn't believe us unless we have data, okay? Okay, well, the neat thing about, The neat thing about cosmology is that we do have data. So, you know, Stephen Hawking wrote this book with a neat title, A Brief History of Time. I'll give you a brief history of the first slow roll parameter, okay? And as a function of a time variable, n, where by n I mean I'm writing a of t as some fixed a times e to the n. So that measures what, that's just sort of a proxy for time. Then what epsilon looks like is we have evidence, actually data, surviving from this period where it's very, very close to zero. We don't quite understand how it got from there to there. We have some theories which will do that, but we don't completely understand it. And then it went along at epsilon equals 2 for a long, long period of time. We have data from this. The lightest elements were synthesized during Big Bang nucleosynthesis. We can actually predict what their isotopic abundances are and then measure them in old clouds of gas that we think have not been processed through supernovae, and we get the right result. It went down to about epsilon equals 3/2 right here. We have data again from this period. The cosmic ray microwave background provides a huge amount of data, about 10 to the 12 pixels of data. And for reasons that are not known, again, what everybody believed was it was going to asymptote out to 3/2. That was why we defined the deceleration parameter with that stupid minus sign in it. But about 6 billion years ago, it took a nosedive down. It's the biggest question in fundamental theory, figuring out why this happens. If you solve it, you're guaranteed to get a Nobel Prize. Okay, so we actually have a huge amount of data on this thing. The only part that we really don't have data for here is there, is that part, the reheating part, and we're going to have data on that within the next 10 years. So so you can actually believe some of the things that I'll tell you, although you should be skeptical too. We have data, very precise data, for two early periods, recombination, when the cosmic ray microwave background came off right about then, and Big Bang nucleosynthesis right about then. Big Bang nucleosynthesis occurred about 1 second after the Big Bang. Recombination occurred about 300,000 years after the Big Bang. Here is about 14 billion years.
It's
matter-radiation equality. So the universe had some matter in it, some non-relativistic matter like us, and then some ultra-relativistic matter like light. And as you go back early, the ultra-relativistic matter gets more and more important and dominates everything. And so as you go later and later and later, so that's dominating everything here. As you go later and later and later, the light redshifts. The same thing, same basic process by which a cop measures your speed on a highway, and so it redshifts and gets weaker and weaker and weaker. Matter gets a little bit weaker, but not as fast, just because the universe is spreading out, so the energy density, which is energy per volume, the volume's increasing, the energy is staying the same, so it gets a little bit weaker, but eventually these two things cross over, and when they cross over, that's called matter-radiation equality, or just EQ for short. So already, you know, if you guys are cruising the physics bars tonight, you know, you've got something where you can have a good pickup line right here. I know what matter radiation equality is. And that will actually get a good reaction. It may not quite be the reaction you intended, but look at it positively. It'll just give you more time to study, and so that's good in the end. Okay, so how do you solve for the scale factor thing? What you do is you plug it into something called the Friedman equation, which is 3 times c squared times h squared is equal to 8 pi Newton's constant times the energy density. And then you have to have a model for what the energy density is. And I think I just told you about what normal matter would be. Energy density, density of anything, is the amount of the thing per unit volume. So it's energy, which for ordinary matter is just constant. It's just the rest mass energy equals mc squared. And that just stays constant. And then the volume is increasing. Why? Because each of the lengths is getting rescaled. Volume, there's three. There are three lengths, right? X, Y, and Z, they didn't change that? Okay, because see, the string theorists do change that kind of stuff now and again, but they haven't done it today. I didn't have a chance to check the HEPTH website, and it might have changed. Anyway, so there's three of them. Each one of them contributes a factor of A, so the volume grows like A to the third, and that means that the energy density, E, this constant over V, which is growing like A to the third, must fall off like A to the third. So if we call its value at the current time, rho naught, then we can write it like that. Okay, so that's our model of the energy density. Once you put that in, then if you evaluated this at T zero, then this would just be one, and that tells you that this combination, rho naught times 8 pi g, is just 3 c squared h naught squared. And so now you've got a first order ordinary differential equation to solve for A. Now I'm told I shouldn't use much calculus, but I can use single variable calculus. And in fact, I won't use it. I'll just give you the answer. So if you take the square root here, and then you have this equation where h is a dot over a is that. And the solution to it is that. It says that A is growing like T to the 2/3 power, and H, which remember is A dot over A, is 2 over 3T. Okay? And this is very characteristic of what's called a decelerating universe. So it's expanding, but if you took another derivative, so if you took the first derivative, it would be T to the minus 1/3. If you took a second derivative, it would be negative. Okay? One thing that we can notice from all of these universes, all of these models, is that the universe at early times was bigger. That is, if you make T, if you make T smaller, then A gets smaller. That means the physical size of the universe gets smaller, and H goes the other way. H grows, because it's 1 over T. As T goes to 0, it goes to infinity. So the early universe is much smaller. That means all the stuff is scrunched together, and it's more dense, and it's got a bigger expansion rate. Okay? Okay, well, let's compare quantum gravity. Remember, I told you that quantum gravity, you need a frequency. We can take the frequency to be h, because it's a frequency, right? It's measured in hertz. And then you take h bar g times that frequency squared over c squared. Let's look at that now. Versus back way, 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 way back here, okay? Well, now it's an incredibly small number, 10 to the minus 122. Again, no way in the world we will ever measure that number. Impossible to measure that number. But at the early universe, at this time, way, 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 way back, it was not so small. It's still small, but it's measurably small. We can measure 10 decimal places. About as many as we can measure is 16 or so. We can measure that many, and that's observable. That's potentially observable. By the way, you might think, oh, wouldn't it be better if it was bigger? No, it actually would not be better, because remember, it's an infinite series of terms that we get, and it's hard to calculate the predictions, the higher order ones, so it's actually better to have it be small, because that means that the higher order ones are negligibly small. So this is really good. This is a good number. If we had to, this is just what the universe dished out to us, but if we had to pick, we would have picked that. Okay, well, you might ask, I told you that we have incredibly powerful evidence that the universe went through this phase of accelerated expansion, okay? So the crossover between accelerated expansion, that is A double dot is positive and A double dot is negative, is here. Okay, so above epsilon equals 1, A double dot is negative. Below, it's positive. Okay, why do we, it's certainly true that it can get to be positive because it's positive now. Why do we have such powerful evidence that it was positive before? And that has to do with something called the horizon problem. There's actually a number of things that it has to do with, but one of them is called the horizon problem. And to look at the horizon problem, we just need one fact that I'm just going to tell you, and that is this invariant element thing, this ds squared, is equal to zero for photons. So in the language of relativity, photons follow null curves. Doesn't that sound sort of awesome? Again, another good pickup line for physics bars, right? What that means is that ds squared is equal to zero for a photon. And by the way, that can tell you something that you see there. If we were in flat space where A is 1, that would tell you dr dt is equal to c, right? And you knew that. That's the speed of light in flat space. In an expanding universe, it's a little bit different. It's got this extra factor of 1 over A. So if we want to figure out how far a photon, how far when we look back, in time, we're looking out, okay? If we want to figure out how far out we can see, then we want to calculate something called the radius of the past light cone. Again, doesn't that sound awesome? A lot of the words here just sound neat. And that's this integral right here. And the horizon problem is if you calculate instead what, so here's us looking back to the time that created the microwave background. So if we're looking back here, this would be the radius of the past light cone. What the horizon problem is that if you went back to the beginning of time and assumed that it didn't have accelerated expansion in the past, then you can calculate what this radius of the future light cone would be. That is, from the beginning of time, how far light could have gone. And what you see is that the past light cone over here encompasses a huge number of future light cones. Why is that so bizarre? The reason why that's so bizarre is that when we do this measurement, again, I told you, you shouldn't believe anything we say unless we have data. We have data, huge amounts of data. When we do this measurement, what we see is that every little bit along here is almost the same temperature, almost the same intensity of light coming off. And in fact, it's agreeing to within 1 part in 10 to the 5th. The temperature, we have a way of measuring what the temperature of this light is using something called Wien's law. And the temperature of this cosmic ray microwave background is 2.72653 to within all the way around, no matter which direction we look, to within 1 part in 10 to the 5th. I don't know if that impresses you as much as it does me, but just think about it a minute. The temperature of the air in this room is not that well defined, right? There's fluctuations of several degrees of temperature in this room. And there's no problem at all explaining about how it achieves thermal equilibrium. If it gets hot here, the stuff moves out and goes over to cool regions, right? Because it's moving faster, it diffuses into cool regions. Here, this future light cone is how far even light, the stuff that moves fastest, can get. And we're seeing something like 2,000 causally disconnected regions, regions that are so small that in the entire history of the universe, they cannot have exchanged a photon. And we're seeing, nonetheless, this thing is in thermal equilibrium to 1 part in 10 to the 5th. Now, you might say, well, maybe that was just the way God wanted it when it started off. But then why wouldn't he have picked perfect thermal equilibrium? Because it's not perfect thermal equilibrium. We've also measured the fluctuations. There really are fluctuations. We've measured those things to about 3 significant figures, too. So we've got a big problem to understand this. And the way to understand it, you can get quantitative about it, and here I actually do the calculations. I think since it's late in the afternoon, I won't torture you with the results. But as you go back earlier and earlier, the radius of the future light cone gets smaller. The radius of the past light cone gets bigger. So it gets worse the earlier back you have data. We have data for the Big Bang nucleosynthesis, and there it's about 10 to the 17th. Causally disconnected regions that are all in approximate thermal equilibrium. How did this happen? Really strange credulity. Well, a period of accelerated expansion can explain that easily, because then instead of A growing like T to the 1/2, it grows like T to some power bigger than 1, okay? And then this integral actually would blow up if you tried to take it down to 0. It could get arbitrarily big. So there is enormously powerful evidence for this phase of early accelerated expansion. Okay, let's go on here. Well, I told you that we can actually even measure the fluctuations, and these fluctuations are quantum gravitational fluctuations. They are the first ever data that has come to us from quantum gravity. And you might say, how do I know that that's quantum gravitational fluctuations, and how did it occur? To do that, I need to tell you a little bit about quantum mechanics. I promise it'll just be a little bit, and it'll actually tell you some stuff, allow you to think creatively about some stuff that you already know. So how many people know that the force of gravity and also the force of electric fields falls off, or the force of two charges falls off like 1 over r squared? Everybody's heard that, that it falls off like 1 over r squared. Newton got hit by the apple and he figured that out. Okay, so we can actually even understand that using this energy time uncertainty principle. It's one of the spookiest things in quantum mechanics. What it says is that due to these quantum fluctuations, you can have a particle just emerge from the vacuum, emerge from empty space. Before, an instant before, you had nothing. An instant later, you have a particle out there. Okay, well, now your first thought is, wait a minute, that violates conservation of energy. So if it had E equals zero before and it has E not equal to zero later on, then that's a violation of conservation of energy. And you physicists told us that that was an exact conservation principle and we shouldn't see those things, and indeed we don't. There's something called the energy time uncertainty principle, which says that provided that you are observing for less than this time h bar over E, you will not be able to resolve the violation of conservation of energy. Okay? So one of the fundamental principles of quantum mechanics, of quantum field theory, tells you that you should imagine that even empty space is actually full of virtual particles that pop in and out of the vacuum. They pop out of the vacuum. They exist for a little bit of time, given by this energy time uncertainty principle. And as they get more energetic, they can only last less time. And then they have to disappear back into the vacuum. Okay, so these particles are characterized by wave numbers. Okay, they're characterized by a wavelength, just saying how big are the fluctuations, the spatial extent of the fluctuations. And if you take 2 pi over that, you get something called the wave number. The energy is given by the Einstein relation. You remember that famous formula E equals mc squared? That's for a particle that has zero wave number, but if it has a non-zero wave number, it's the square root, that's the 1/2 power, of m squared c to the fourth plus c squared h bar squared, there's that quantum thing, times k squared, okay? And actually, just using this little bit of quantum field theory, you can understand why it is that massless particles like photons, like light particles, and gravitons have 1 over r squared forces. The way to think about it is that if you have a massless particle, then this term drops out, and E is just coming from the square root of that term. So that's C h bar k. That means, according to the energy time uncertainty principle, that a particle with wave number k can exist, or a photon with wave number k can exist for a time 1 over C k. Okay? How far can it get in that amount of time? It gets a distance r. It's moving at the speed of light, so it gets a distance r equals c delta t, which is 1 over k. And how much momentum does it transfer? Because if any of you have taken basic physics, you know that the force is the amount of momentum transferred per unit time, right? So we take delta p over delta t. We know what delta t is here. Delta p is just h bar k. So you put these two things together, and you get h bar c k squared. Use that k is 1 over r, and you've got the 1 over r squared force law. So this kind of crazy thing actually explains to you why it is that massless particles have 1 over r squared forces. So both gravity and electromagnetism are characterized by, those forces are carried by massless particles. In the electromagnetism's case, it's the photon. In gravity's case, it's the graviton. You can also understand why the nuclear forces, which are carried by massive particles, are short range. Because if they have a non-zero mass and you have only a small wave number, then the energy is almost all from this term, and that's your famous formula, E is equal to mc squared. That means that delta T doesn't get smaller or doesn't get bigger and bigger as k gets closer to zero. It's actually got a minimum amount that it can't ever get less than, and that means that the distance is just fixed. Okay, and that's why the nuclear force and the weak force have short-range interactions. So with this crazy idea, you can understand some things that you actually already knew. Okay, well, how does all of this change if you're in an expanding universe? You remember I told you that lengths have to be multiplied by this scale factor thing, this A of T thing, in order to become physical. Okay? It turns out that the wave number of a particle is still fixed. Okay, so that's still this constant 2 pi over lambda, but the physical lambda is A times lambda. That means that in anything physical, like an energy, the wave number, it has to be not K, but K over A that enters that thing. So the energy changes from the simple Einstein relation here to the Einstein relation divided by an A. You might think that's a trivial change, but it's actually profound. What that means is that if you wait longer and longer, this term goes to zero, because the universe expands and expands and gets bigger and bigger and bigger. Just as in flat space, the biggest, the longest lifetimes are associated with massless particles, where this guy drops out. So if this guy drops out, then E is just C h bar k over A. And then guess what? C h bar k can be factored out. It's a constant, and you've got this integral dt over A. Have we ever seen this before? Okay, I quite often tease my students. You know, I tell them, you know, that you shouldn't really care about humans because we're physicists, right? And the humans don't care about us. But mathematical expressions have feelings. And we've actually seen this mathematical expression before. It is exactly that same one that occurred there. And you remember the key difference between inflation, that is accelerated expansion, and decelerated expansion is that for something which is decelerating, what everybody thought the universe was before this measurement that won the 2011 Nobel Prize was, what everybody thought was, then this integral will grow without bound. Okay, if this was like t to the 1/2, then the integral of it would be t to the 1/2, and it would grow as you made delta t bigger and bigger and bigger. So the expansion of the universe would allow a particle to last longer, so it would increase quantum effects, but it would still be finite. But suppose we had accelerated expansion, where this was like a to the t, or a was like t squared, for example. Then the integral of that would be 1 over t, and even when you took delta t to infinity, it would not blow up. What does that mean? That means an amazing, amazing, astounding thing. What it means is that a virtual particle that emerges from the vacuum during inflation can live forever. It never has to disappear. That is the source of these quantum fluctuations that we've measured. There are actually two kinds of these perturbations. There's scalar perturbations and tensor perturbations. They come from two different kinds of things, okay? So first off, I told you that, well, we're talking about gravity, right? And I told you you shouldn't believe anything without data, so I'll do an experiment right there. We see that gravity responds to a source of energy density, right? And that's what the scalar fluctuations are. So the energy density in the early universe is quantum mechanical, as everything is. It's undergoing fluctuations. Those fluctuations get imprinted into the gravitational field. That's what causes the scalar perturbations. There also are dynamical gravitons. Just like there are photons, there's gravitational radiation. And again, I told you you shouldn't believe anything without data, right? Well, we've actually, your parents spent, well over a billion dollars building two LIGO detectors, laser gravitational interferometry observatories, one of them in Hanford, Washington, the other in Louisiana. They will turn on next year, I think, and they are guaranteed to see a source, or else general relativity is wrong. Previously, the sensitivity before the upgrade was so small that they shouldn't have seen any source, although we might have gotten lucky and seen one. But we are right on the verge of being able to detect gravitons. And maybe, you know, 2 or 3 years, I'll have to come back and explain why we didn't detect gravitons. By the way, that would be really interesting, too. That would be a great result as well. But the point is that we will very, very quickly have proof that gravitational radiation exists. And of course, everything is quantum mechanical, so those things fluctuate as well. So there are gravitational fluctuations in the field, just like the field right here that's holding us down on this planet. And then there are gravitational radiation fluctuations as well. And both of those get created during this period of accelerated expansion. Okay, well, getting created during accelerated expansion is not enough, because that was a long, long, long long time ago, and a lot of stuff happened after that. You have to have a way for them to fossilize, to get preserved so that they survive to late times. And it turns out there is a way to do that. The way to do that comes by just looking at this key thing, the c times the wave number versus h of t, a of t. Okay? And it turns out that there are two interesting regimes. When ck is very much bigger than this, then the perturbations oscillate, and they also fall off, like 1 over a. That would be really bad for us, because 1 over a is growing by a huge factor. Between the end of inflation and now, it grew by a factor of 10 to the 56. Okay, it would be negligibly small by now. Okay, but there's a second regime where ck is very much less than h of t, and then what happens is the perturbations become constant. Not really complicated to understand why they become constant. They become constant for the same reason as the horizon problem's a problem. That is just causality. They're too big for anything local to affect them. They're bigger than the radius of the universe. They've gotten pulled outside of the universe, hence the name horizon crossing. They've been extended past the causal horizon. Okay? Okay, so suppose that A of t was just a power, t to the n. What would h be? Well, it's a dot over a, so that's n over t. If you put the two together, that goes like some constant times t to the n minus 1. Okay? Okay, well, that will grow when n is greater than 1. So for inflation, that's going to grow. For deceleration, which is what people thought the universe was now, but they were wrong, and in any case, what certainly was after the end of inflation, it will fall. Okay, so the life cycle of any mode that we can actually see, and remember, to see it, to observe the perturbation, it has to be inside the horizon. That is, the wavelength has to be bigger, or excuse me, has to be smaller than the radius of the universe. So in the beginning, they started out in this regime where they were very, very energetic. They were oscillating and falling off. But then remember, during inflation, this guy is growing. So even though this guy's bigger, this guy's growing, and growing pretty rapidly. And eventually, for ones where this guy's not too big, this side overtakes that. That's called first horizon crossing. That's when the size of the wavelength becomes equal to the wavelength, the radius of the universe. And at that point, the wave just freezes in. It fossilizes, just like a dinosaur skeleton fossilizes. And then inflation ends. And we go to decelerated expansion, where this side begins falling off. Okay, so as it falls off, then it could go the other way, right? That's called second horizon crossing. That has to happen for us to be able to observe them. But it doesn't have to happen way early. It could happen late. And those are the ones that we can observe. You might ask, how do we observe them? Well, I already told you that the early universe is a lot smaller, which means it's dense. It's also hot, because when you squish stuff together, it gets hot, right? That means that even hydrogen cannot survive. Hydrogen is the most common element in the universe, about 75% of the universe. And it cannot survive. It breaks up into electrons and positrons. Those are charged particles. And one of the fundamental things about electromagnetism is that it interacts with charged particles. So whereas a light ray could go pretty much past a hydrogen atom, a neutral hydrogen atom, without getting affected, when it sees that electron and proton, it gets scattered. It gets bounced around. That means they can't go very far. Okay? The universe, however, cools off as it expands. Again, that's not complicated. That's just exactly what would happen in a jar of gas, right? If you, in fact, that's the way. Does anybody an engineer who actually makes refrigeration units? That's how you can make. That's how you can liquefy gas, is just by expanding it like that. Okay, so it would cool off, and eventually, at a key temperature that we can calculate, about 3,000 degrees Kelvin. These guys join together to form hydrogen. Okay, at that instant, the universe suddenly becomes neutral. The photons, which were previously getting bounced around, they can propagate freely. That's called free streaming. And what do they do? Well, they propagate through basically empty space, but remember, space isn't really empty. It's full of those perturbations that we just saw, the scalar perturbations and the tensor perturbations. What do? They do exactly the same thing that the GPS signal does when it has to migrate up to the satellites. When it falls out of a gravitational potential, it loses a little bit of energy. When it falls into a gravitational potential, it gains a little bit of energy. And that's the thing that's responsible for those fluctuations that we actually have measured in the cosmic ray microwave background. It also, in a more complicated way, affects polarization. You know that light is polarized, right? You've seen those polarized sunglasses and things. Okay? And actually, a map of the sky looks like this. Okay? So this is a map of the full sky. Real data, and the things which are blue are cool spots, the things which are red are warm spots, but actually, to first approximation, these are tiny, tiny fluctuations, one part in 10 to the fifth. Really, it almost all looks uniform, but there are tiny fluctuations, and we've measured them. There's about 10 to the 12th pixels of data in that. And we can measure polarization as well. There was recently an experiment this spring that announced BICEP 2 announced there. We can make theoretical predictions for what the scalar power spectrum is and for what the tensor power spectrum is. And we actually can take this measured data and fit it to this form and get these coefficients. It blows my mind that we've got this to three significant figures. We can get the so-called spectral index, the tensor to scalar ratio, et cetera. And really exciting, there is a huge amount more data available because what we're looking at right now is cosmic ray microwave background radiation from these photons that are there. We also can see 21 centimeter radiation. The most common radiation in the universe is 21 centimeter radiation coming, well, if you go to a physics bar tonight, you can say, I know that 21 centimeter radiation comes from the hyperfine transition of hydrogen. And again, that will have a big effect. It may not quite be what you wanted, but it'll just accelerate what would have happened anyway. And it's the most common radiation in the universe. People have suggested that it be used to communicate with extraterrestrials. We can see this stuff out to huge distances, and that allows us to take, we can see it from forming protostructures in the early universe, and that allows us to, instead of like taking an X-ray of the universe, which is what measuring the cosmic ray microwave background is, because see, it's coming from this instant when the hydrogen formed, the neutral hydrogen formed, we can actually get a tomograph of the universe. Huge amount more data. It's been calculated that there's a factor of 10 to the 8th increase in data, so 10 to the 30th pixels of data. Oh, these are things that just are intoxicating. I mean, there's no drug that can give me the amount of high that I get from that. This would not be easy to see. It would take a lot of stuff. Like somebody said that they were an astrophysics aerospace engineer. You would have to build a radio telescope, a dedicated radio telescope on the far side of the moon to avoid interference with Earth. You'd have to have superb understanding of the astrophysical processes so that you could separate out the cosmological signal from just late-time astrophysics signals. And you'd have to have a unique theory for what caused inflation. But this is not going to be done anytime soon. It's maybe 30 years in the future. And I really believe that with all this data, no matter how stupid we are, we're going to be gradually drawn to getting the right answer. So some of you are getting sort of nervous now. You're thinking, it's after 6. Is he going to drone on? How much longer is he going to drone on? I'm done. So let me just give you my conclusions. So let me remind you that quantum gravitational effects, which are generated now, are they're occurring right now, but they're unobservably small. However, quantum gravitational effects from inflation, although they're still small, and by the way, small is good because that means we don't have to include the higher terms. They're observable, and they're occurring for three reasons. First, epsilon during inflation is less than 1, and that means that virtual particles are just ripped out of the vacuum by this process that I told you using the energy-time uncertainty principle. Second, the Hubble parameter, the inflationary Hubble parameter, is about 56 orders of magnitude bigger than the current Hubble parameter, so it turns a small result, a hopelessly small result, into one that's small but not hopelessly small. And finally, also very important, they get fossilized by just being stretched out to be so big that nothing can affect them. And they survive until late times when they re-enter, and then we can finally see them. There are two power spectra, the scalar one, which has already been measured. It comes from the gravitational response of quantum matter. And the tensor power spectra, BICEP2 claimed that it had seen that, but I think most people believe that really that what they saw was, they did measure something, but what they saw was just the effect due to polarized dust emission in our own galaxy. Okay. By the way, that's what I meant when I said superb astrophysics, because you really, really have to understand what's going on so you can untangle the primordial cosmological effect from late time effects like what BICEP2 probably is. And there will be enough data in the end to resolve not just the first-order effect, but actually the second-order effect, which, remember, is bearing on that wildly wrong prediction of quantum gravity that the pure numbers in front of everything are infinity. So actually what's happening right now and will happen for the next couple of decades, because although these problems are being solved, they're not going to be solved soon, what's happening is that quantum gravity is coming of age as a science. It's going from being a situation where there just wasn't any data, you could say any stupid thing you wanted to and nobody could disprove you. Now there actually is data, and in fact, some of the first theories have been falsified and shown to be wrong. Much of string theory has been shown to be wrong. So so it's really an exciting time, and I'm really excited about it, and I hope some of you may go on to work in this subject or at least provide the technological infrastructure that we need to resolve some of this stuff. So I'm done droning on. I'll stop at this point and entertain questions.